Welcome to the Phillips MRX Defibrillator Skills Ambassador video. I'm going to review the defibrillator with you as well as all of the equipment that you would need to make it work during a code situation. So to start with, you'll need your defibrillator. You'll also need the pads to attach to your patient. There are adult pads and pediatric pads. Pediatric pads would be used on a patient less than 10 kilos, and adult pads are for any kid over 10 kilos. You could also need your redux gel or the defib pads. If you're using the paddles, you'll need these. And then you'll also need your EKG electrodes. So, moving on to the monitor. For your monitor, the way that we keep it set up here is that we always keep the attachment for the pads attached to the monitor. Because that's what's used most frequently in the hospital setting. So, and you've got this test load that's attached to it. This allows us to check the defibrillator and not shock anybody. So it dumps the electricity there. To turn on your defibrillator, you have a couple of different settings and options here. One of them is the AED option over to the left. We don't use this in the hospital setting because it actually will only recommend defibrillation for a VFib rhythm, and your clinical eye, you know, if you have a VTAC without a pulse, the monitor doesn't know that you don't have a pulse, so it won't recommend defibrillation. So we want you to interpret your rhythms and do that on your own because you understand the whole clinical situation. So we don't use AED in the clinical setting. You do have a monitor option that allows you to monitor a patient that you're transporting if you need to take the full defibrillator because you're concerned they may code in the hallway. We want to make sure that you have that ability, so you do have a monitor option. Your silence button, when the alarm's going off, you actually have the ability to silence from here. You also have this button here that you can silence the machine with, and this will silence it for a 2-minute time frame. We do not ever use the monitor setting during a code situation. It should always be on something else, but that is only for if you're transporting a stable patient. You do have a pacer setting that we're going to go over in a little bit. And then you've got all of your Joule settings that is how you set for defibrillation or synchronized cardioversion. If you have a patient that is small, let's say you have a 4 kilo patient, and so you need, you're starting at 2 joules per kilo, you need to set it to 8 joules. You can select the 1 through 10 setting, and then you can adjust that. It defaults to 6 joules, but you can adjust it with the arrows here at the bottom. So you can adjust it to 8 joules. Once you've decided what you want, hit the check mark, and you can see here on the defibrillator screen that you've got it set to 8 joules. Of course, going up, let's say you have a patient that needs 25 joules based on their weight. We don't have that option because it does start to skip as you get higher up, but it's always better to do a little bit more than not enough of that life-saving thing. So instead of 20, we would jump up to 30. Again, you've got it selected here where you can verify what your selected joules are. Now talking about defibrillation or synchronized cardioversion, defibrillation is for VTAC without a pulse or your VFib rhythms, and we would start at 2 to 4 joules per kilo. That can go 2, 4, 6, 8. That's the dose to defibrillate. You can go up to 10 joules per kilo or to the max adult dose. While this is labeled, the 150 is labeled at the adult dose, that is the starting adult dose, you can actually go up to 200 with this monitor. And that is defibrillator specific, of course. So adult dosing or 10 joules per kilo, whichever is lower. For synchronized cardioversion, your patient's only half dead, so you're gonna use half the joules. So we do 0.5 to 1 joules per kilo to start with. And you can go up from there, but of course, if you're having to go up too high and your patient is alert, please make sure to consider sedation. Speaking of synchronized cardioversion, you set the joules the same way. So let's say we've got, you know, a patient who needs 15 joules for a synchronized cardioversion, so it's 0.5 to 1 joules per kilo. Before I get started, we're gonna have to hit this sync button. It's a little bit hard to see on this monitor because it does blend in, but it does say sync right above it. And it will actually look, of course, right now it's saying R-wave not detected because I don't have a patient hooked up. but it will actually place a white dot above every R wave, and so that it's detecting that R wave to prevent the R on T phenomenon and prevent sending your patient into VFib. If you have a rhythm with a pulse, this is important to use so that we don't make the patient worse. You also get this flashing sync button here. We're gonna turn that off for now. Once you have your Joule set, you've hit the sync button. If you're doing a synchronized cardioversion, you're gonna come over here to charge. I'm gonna make sure I have it connected to my test load for now because I don't wanna be electrocuted. But I'm gonna come over here to charge and hit that. When that's charging, when it's ready to go, the orange will start to flash. I'm gonna put my finger here, look over at my friends. I'm clear, you're clear, oxygen is clear. We always wanna make sure oxygen's clear so we don't set our patient on fire. Everyone's clear. I don't turn around and look at this. This monitor is not walking away. So I'm going to look at everybody, see that everybody's clear, and then I'm gonna hit my button. If you have it on the synchronized cardiovert option, and you have it syncing, you may actually need to press and hold that button until you see a response in your patient. It can be up to 3 seconds for the monitor to find that R wave and make sure that it doesn't shock on the R wave. If it doesn't find that and you just push it, it may not deliver the shock because it didn't find that R wave and it wasn't a safe shock to deliver. So you may need to hold it for a longer period of time until you see the response from your patient. Couple of other things to go over now. Oh. Couple of other things on here while we're talking about this. So right now you can see it's in the mode to read from the EKG leads. If you're using paddles or the internal defibrillator and you need to synchronize cardiovert, you will have to have leads on your patient and you'll want to be reading from those leads so that it can pick up on that R wave. Once I have my pads plugged in, so I've got my pads here. Talking about the pads real quick, if you're talking about placement, it does show a picture on the pads themselves, but you can put it upper right and lower left is the way that you want to place the pads on your patient. If they're touching at all, you cannot use them that way, and you need to do one on the front and one on the back. You can use your infant pads on pediatric patients less than 10 kilos only. Adult pads can be used on pediatric patients or adult patients, but infant pads may not be used on adult patients. So when I go to connect my pads, I'm gonna remove my test load, put that in the bag so that it doesn't disappear and walk away in the middle of my chaotic code, and then I'm gonna connect like this. So that's how the connection works. Once that's connected, let's make sure that it's, then I can change this so that it will actually read from the pads. So I don't have to have those EKG electrodes on. In order to get a rhythm, I can actually read a rhythm from these pads as long as I've got them attached to the patient. So looking at this, one of the things that's important to know, again, we keep this hooked up to pads here in the hospital setting. But if I need to change to internal defibrillator pads or to the paddles or to these paddles, I'm gonna need to disconnect right here. There's a small green connector here that I'm gonna push down with my thumb and then pull this out. So it's just pushing down like this, comes right off. The hardest part is getting to it when you've got this thing on the side. And then I'm gonna connect, in this case, my paddles or the internal defibrillator pads. That's where they're going to connect. You can just push it in as long as it's lined up the correct way. And then that will allow me to switch over to what I need. So for now, I want my pads plugged in. So that is what we use most often. There we go. So sometimes it's a little bit tricky to get that on there, especially when this thing's on. So you can take that off using these Velcro tabs. Now, one of the other things we need to go over is how to pace a patient. So occasionally patients need transthoracic pacing. So we're gonna put the pads on and pace them until they can get a permanent pacemaker placed. The way that we're gonna do that is by turning to the pacer function here. We're gonna have the pads on our patient. And then you get these options down here. So here you can adjust pacer rate. Click on it, use your arrows to adjust the rate to what you want. say I have a young kid, I want a rate of 120. And then here I'm going to adjust my output. For infant patients, we're going to set the output to start with at 10 and then go up until we see capture. So I'm dropping it down to 10. I'm going to see, are we actually getting capture on our monitor, on our electrical rhythm? But I not only need electrical capture, I also need mechanical capture, because I could be pacing the patient and they're getting the electricity, but we're not actually causing a squeeze in the ventricles. And essentially you're mimicking a PEA. So we want to make sure that we're getting mechanical capture. When you see that you're getting electrical capture, go over, check your pulse, make sure that that's lining up with what you're seeing on the monitor. As I adjust that and go up, let's say they need 25 and that's where we see our capture, then I'm going to want to go up 5 more, because as you're pacing your patient, there's going to start to be some inflammation from the electricity that you're giving. So you always want to go 5 above on your output to make sure that you continue to get capture even after you've been pacing for a little while. Then once I'm ready to go, I'll hit start pacing, and if I have it connected to a patient, it would actually start pacing, but it'll allow me to do my settings first. We're going to silence that. So I think that's everything on our review. Oh, I did want to show you your EKG cables here to the side that you'll need to connect if you're using internal defibrillator paddles or the paddles here at the top. We can also go over the top here on your defibrillator. Let's turn this around a little bit so that you can see better. There's a couple of things that you need to know about here on the back. One is your battery indicator lights right here. When you push this little button to the side, there will be 5 green lights. You need at least 4 of them to be green in order for the monitor to function appropriately. When you take this into a code room, you want to make sure that you plug it in so that you don't have to worry about that battery draining and getting down to less than 80%. The other thing that you need to be aware of is how these paddles work. You can actually pull them out this way. Just pull out, you've got your paddles, and you have your charge button here on the side, and then you've got your shock buttons. However, often that's a little bit difficult to coordinate, so we do recommend that if you've got somebody there holding the paddles, that you still have somebody at the monitor doing the buttons from here. Either one will work. Of course, if you are using paddles, that's when you're going to use your redux gel or your defib pads. Need to be on the patient. The gel you can put on the paddles to put on the patient, but it helps with your conduction through that transthoracic space and prevents burns on your patient. So those are very important to have on when you're using paddles. All right, so that concludes our Phillips MRX defibrillator video. Thank you for joining us. I'll see you soon.